They're short, they're sweet, but I think that you can use, so the tools that you have there with you is, again, you've got the listening summary, you've got the survey summary, and then you've got the guidance. But we want you to take 5 minutes and you write your own mission, your vision statement. Gosh, my performance should be, can I actually remember vision versus mission? But we're going to scratch that. So we want you to take 5 minutes, use your piece of paper, write down your ideas, get one sentence together, and then we're going to go into Mentimeter. We're going to have you put that sentence up. It'll be anonymous. And then we're going to see what common themes did you all come up with. So I'm setting the timer for 5 minutes, maybe. Please take your time. Any questions before we get started? All right. And your 5 minutes has started.
Instead of the word being, you could say becoming, you could say developing, you could say Xing.
Yeah.
Yes.
Just use that as a guide.
Yeah, it helps you build it.
No, yeah, this is just a guide. You can make it as long or as short as you want.
As long as you can make a sentence.
Yeah, and that's why we gave you paper to kind of write down your thoughts. I didn't know your creative process, so I wanted to give you all the opportunities that you have. But yeah, you don't need to do five things. This is just how we often.
And just as a reminder, because you do have a copy of your old strategic plan there, your previous vision statement was South Florida's top city to live, learn, work, invest, and play. But that was the past 100 years. We're talking about the future 100 years. Halfway through, and if you need more time, that's fine. We just figured 5 minutes would be probably enough, but we are happy to give you more time. Oh yeah, well, I'm gonna let it ring in the That's exactly why we wanted to do it. Got 1 minute, 30 seconds. This commission's used to working off pressure. Now looking at 1 minute left.
Are we going to be typing this in somewhere?
We are. Okay. Yep. So that's what, take your time. Slow is smooth, smooth is fast. But I will say, if you need extra time, we're negotiating, so that means you need to take me out to dinner because I've given you more time. Because who would? Yes. Okay. Yeah. That will motivate anybody.
You did say creating a vision statement requires thought, so you know sometimes that's more than 5 minutes. But in any case, yeah. I like the exercise. I have something on paper.
Yeah, and that's the intent of it is we because. And Mayor, what's really important to this exercise is that we're hearing from you.
Yeah.
We really need that feedback because there is just no way. We talked about it related to the staff, and it's this is your lane. And if we're jumping to it, and I even thought about doing. All right. Does anybody need more time? I still see a few pens writing though. Vice Mayor, do you need a little more time? Oh, 1 minute.
Yeah, take him out to dinner.
So I'm a big fan of Chick-fil-A. I'll let you off easy. I guess we'll be meeting there.
There's no Chick-fil-A in the city of Hollywood.
What? How did I not know that? Well, yeah.
There you go. We solved the problem.
Okay. Yep. All right, I guess because... All right, so now what you'll do is you're going to use the QR code, and that is going to send you to the Mentimeter, which once everybody's logged into it, and again, and Amy, remind me, so it's anonymous. We're not going to see it because the intent is for you to feel comfortable with you putting it out there, and then we're going to take common elements and build that on our work board. Yeah, in your packet. Oh, that's true. Yeah, you have printouts of everything, too.
I have a page that says instructions.
Yep.
So we stay there?
Yep.
Until he says okay.
Oh, you can hit go, I think.
And then we just have to sign in.
No, there's just a check, like a thumbs up.
Just a thumbs up if you got it.
Just leave the thumbs up there.
Just thumbs up. Okay. Yeah. All right, so Amy, should I do the... Okay, here?
I'm sorry.
Oh, I did it right. There we go. All right. So we got six of you.
Hold on, I'm helping Vice Mayor Harrell call.
Yep.
Is Raheem here?
That's all good.
Yeah, and then Aaron.
Now we're on the same page.
Do you know the system? Can you help out, or Amy? Do you want to help out if anybody needs help?
You said it's Wi-Fi now?
Yeah, we have seven, so everybody is logged in at this time. Okay, so now what do I do?
I'm still not assumed to this.
Oh, he's not. So I feel bad.
Oh, it is. It's a team.
It's all right.
See, there you go. So what is your vision? So now should be that opportunity that you can type in your sentence, your paragraph, your two-word response. It's awesome. I like that as well.
But not everything.
So type in our sentence?
That's right. Yep. So now type in your sentence.
Oh, it is? Okay. Okay, thank you. Sorry about that. Well,
we don't know it's you until you say it's you.
Okay, because they can keep typing. Oh, that's right, because it's how you close out.
Well, this is what it said.
I mean, I can.
She can go back in.
No,
sense, yeah.
No using ChatGPT. Although I did try it. It was kind of fun. I prompted it to say, give me the best mission statement you could have using this phone. Actually worked better than I thought.
Well, see me out of a job. Sorry, all.
We do have a wild chicken now, or whatever that place is on US 1 is called. It's pretty good.
Oh, it is pretty good.
Are you hungry?
Oh, there it
is.
I was telling someone about that the other day.
Yeah. So. Oh, and just type on Aaron's phone? Yeah, that's a good idea. Good, it's a backup. One is none, two is one.
So are we just saying on thanks for joining?
Yeah, so we're going to hold here for a minute, and essentially what we're going to do is we're going to look for common themes, and I want some consensus from you all as to what are the pieces that you are absolutely wiring as part of this process. Again, I want this statement to reflect you. So in a sense, we're taking your words and mashing them together, but we have to identify what's important to begin with. It actually seems really good work.
I think that's surprising. Buddy, hit next too soon.
Forget.
Yeah.
If it stops typing, does that mean we ran out of words?
You broke the system.
Leave it to a lawyer to be wordy.
A one-time engineer too, right?
That's
like
right.
It should have been brevity. The bridge can't fall down, so. I am too. Yep. So 1, 2, 3. Okay, so we've got two more. Well, and that's why these are fun.
I'm seeing
each other's personality because I could pick out who wrote what.
I'm seeing some themes.
There's a lot of pride in knowing one another.
Sure.
Well,
yeah. And I was like, are you kidding me?
See who writes what.
Well, we listen to each other for hours
when
at
you
a
finish?
Time.
Submit. You done?
No.
Yeah.
Well, we hear you each other for hours at a time.
Oh, and that one. Now, can we scroll down then? Amy, to be able to show that? Okay.
It's eight.
Okay, because, yeah, there's, yeah, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay. Oh, there. Oh, I get, okay, so we just know it's technologies. Okay. All right, so we know what it is. All right, so I'm hearing people say themes. What are the themes you're seeing? Talk to me.
One of a kind and magical talk about the same thing. You know, family can be mixed in with the word residence. We talked about business a few times, economic, healthy, prosperous.
Diverse
is another theme.
Yeah.
And
I
also economically diverse, I see as a theme here, not just, you know, demographically.
Well, and that's what I think diversity is kind of hitting all this, right? All walks of life, all kinds of, and the idea that you're.
I don't know that we can say that word in Florida anymore, can we?
Oh, do we need to go there?
We don't.
Look, I'll take it on because, yeah, that. So I like where you're going.
I think the word everyone is good. Everyone. Mm-hmm. You know, everyone means everyone. It's also the county's tourism tagline, everyone under the sun.
Oh, yeah,
it
correct.
It was meant to speak to that. And so when we say everyone, we understand that it's all of us.
Yeah, and I think that makes sense because how does everybody feel about making sure that we're using terminology that everyone can just appreciate, right? Because everyone versus diverse, like using something that really becomes, and I don't like the idea of like the common, because anybody who's alive is a person, right? But it's how can we speak to the most people with the greatest amount of ease?
You know, our city's founder in one of the earliest, you know, publications or you know, vision statements that we have began with a city for everyone. And then he went into, you know, those at the highest of the economic and social ladder to the most humble of working men. So that was the founding vision of the city.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Well, it is on. Yeah.
Yep. All right. So,
yeah.
So give us your thoughts.
And the city is actually that.
Yeah. Yeah. It lived up to what it was supposed to 100 years later. So now we're going to set it for the next 100 years. Yeah. All right. So we've got one of a kind, which is kind of magical, resident family, diverse. And let's use everyone here. So that way we're kind of connecting those two. Healthy, prosperous. Are there other words that you want us to incorporate into this vision? Because basically, this is now recorded. We have this. We can build, put it through Grammarly, clean it up to really just hit it, to nail it, to bring all of your elements together. This vision statement is going to be a reflection of all of you. Every one of you is going to have a piece of what you just gave us in there. This is what we're seeing here as the priorities. Do you agree with what we've documented there?
So I like the fact that we reference South Florida and our place in this thriving region of the country. Because, you know, it's the why. Why Hollywood? Well, Hollywood is within this vibrant mix of South Florida, yet we're one of a kind. We're special and we're unique. And so I think if you tell someone we have a one of a kind city in South Florida, then they already, by hearing South Florida, they think it's a vibrant, energetic place, and one of a kind for life. Of course, I'm kind of reading my own statement there a little bit, but I kind of want to, and we're all kind of getting to that, is how do we describe
the
uniqueness that we talked about in the listening session back in March, that charm, that unique charm that Hollywood has, and why we wanted to get away from the bland top city for South Florida's live, learn, work, invest, and play, was because we wanted to better, communicate what makes Hollywood special and unique. It's why people love living here versus another city in South Florida that doesn't have the same character. We're unique in our own way. So.
Yeah, agreed. Right, is everybody comfortable? Do you feel like you've heard? Oh, please.
Very comfortable, but one thing Adelma said earlier, which I liked, and I don't know how we would incorporate it. I think somebody said work collaboratively, but I like the idea of making part of the vision statement something that includes the residents and businesses in sustaining this vision. I don't know if it needs to be stated that way, but it's kind of like we're saying what this is, and we're saying that people live here and work here, but I liked the idea of having in even the vision statement that they're participants in this, you know, where everybody can and does participate in maintaining this vision.
And that's kind of why I threw in healthy, because one of our major staples, and granted I do work there, but if you don't have your health, you have no quality of life. And we have one of the South Broward's biggest hospital districts that work, live, and play in our city. So that's why I kind of honed in on healthy, because then you can really form everything around it, and you don't need the hospital for that, right? If you don't have health, you have no quality of life. So that's why I threw that in there, and then I put by, because then it opens it up for a lot more that we can add to it. But I think that that really encompasses all of our businesses as well, because you can't go out and enjoy dinner if you're not healthy. You can't go to the beach and parks, and if you don't have that aspect of health that you can ambulate and get to where you gotta go. And so then everybody can thrive off of that. So I was going in the same direction, so thank you for bringing
that up. So Todd, some of that goes into mission.
I was going to say, I think we can actually link that together, and it's a nice interlude into that, because that was the one that I was going to read from Perth that was an award-winning strategic plan, was to make it livable by ensuring a community that is safe, socially cohesive, inclusive, and activated.
Mm.
And that's a great mission statement to get there. Yeah, I was like, it was just gold.
And you found that from some other city? Is that what that was?
Yeah, and I'm always monitoring these things and trying to look to see, like, oh, what's other cities doing? What's kind of award-winning? What's best practices? Amy and I actually keep the pulse of this constantly to try to hit that. So we actually keep a database of all that. So when something new pops up, we can start to see trends, too. Because essentially what we're going to do is we're going to trend analysis this. So we're going to basically, as Sean's going to put it through his AI that numbers all of the wording, so we see which words pop up the most. We're going to test that against what you have here and then mold the two together.
I'm sorry. No, continue.
No, and then what we'll do is we're going to test that, though, against the other ones that we've seen as best practices, just to see if there's anything interesting that could at least either bring brevity to it or clarity.
So I get the whole thing about keeping the axe sharp, and
wanting to continue to improve and update. Is there like a, and I have another follow-up, but is there like a standard or best practice on how often we should be updating our vision and mission statement? Because, I mean,
there is.
It's great to keep sharpening that axe, but to keep reinventing things, I think, loses the whole future vision.
And I don't disagree. And actually, that's going to be the second phase of this, is we're going to talk about some of those policies. So, and for those that were involved before, if you recall, when I ended the last process, I said, hey, this is your first strategic plan. Let's see how you investigate it, how you move forward with it. But I had said at that time, your next steps to continuing the maturity of your plan would be to put in policies that answer exactly those questions. How often do you update it? And you create triggers to that, because you don't want to be changing that target all the time.
I mean, as it is,
staff needs time to actually fulfill it. Adam's saying yes.
Right,
yes,
and
yes.
I mean, as it is, the plan changes every 4 to 8 years as the seats rotate. And just to follow up, I mean, I think it's very aspirational to want to include every resident. It's great. I mean, it, in theory, but as we see by the survey, it's virtually impossible. So we have to do what we can to balance the vision of the commission and the most vocal residents.
Agreed. I hear the, no, this is a negotiation. You don't agree. No, give us your thoughts.
My thought is that the survey is not the only source of information that we should use to inform our input. Because people didn't participate in the survey doesn't mean that they don't have a thought or opinion. They just don't necessarily understand that their thought or opinion, first of all, can have something to do with what we do here. And secondly, I mean, people are busy. I don't know that if we have multiple surveys that we give them that we're going to get any more of a response from anybody different than who is currently there. I think the way that we get to them is more than a survey. It has to be multiple methods.
Yeah, that was just what our scope.
No, and it's not anything about the survey. I'm more responding to Commissioner Biederman's observation about it's virtually impossible to engage everyone, and we won't engage everyone. But certainly we can engage more people than we did if we only look at the survey. There's other ways to engage people, and that all of it should inform, right? Because we all talk to our constituents, and we all have some perspective that we hear from them. So there's other sources of information. This is just one.
Oh, I completely agree with you. And I think, though, on the compromise side of it is, and this is something that, George, we can work with on the performance side, is what kind of measures do you have for engagement, and what does that look like? Because to your point, everybody is very busy, but it doesn't mean that your actions are impacting them. And I think being able to find clever ways to try to get them more involved or heard can be helpful. But the one thing I'll say, after working with electeds for 30 years, you do know your constituents.
Yeah.
I mean, you really do. I've yet to meet one that does not know the people that you serve. So that's where you guys become so important to it. That's why I wanted you part of this. You're writing it. So I think, though, to get to that point is, how do we make sure that as we're monitoring the plan, are more people getting engaged, yes or no? And it can be a measure as to how effective it is. Does that seem like a fair compromise that we could try to integrate that into
Absolutely.
That process?
Absolutely, yes.
Okay.
I think if I could, what the mayor had stated, maybe what would give us a little bit a more balance, it's, we're a fluid city, so we always have to change to some extent. But I think if we take the vision of Joseph Young, which the mayor eloquently stated, we kind of feed off of that. So sometimes you go in a different direction, but you end up going back to the core. And so maybe if we had that vision statement of originality, right, that Joseph Young started, and then we change and everything changes, but sometimes you always end up back home. And so I think that with all of this information, you know, we kind of tend to go in the direction that it's leaning, but then we always end up back to the core. And I think that's maybe what this whole process is about. Our vision statement changes, but at the end of the day, it brings us back to our core of what the city of Hollywood is.
Yeah, I think that's an excellent point, because it becomes your North Star. Because from a company standpoint, in 15 years, we haven't changed our mission or vision, and we're very happy. So, and we continue to say that's what we're striving for. Right. And cities are different. Atlanta, they've had theirs for about 20 years, but some of them change them yearly. Some of them, so we'll get into that, though, is like, what's the triggers? So hold that thought. All right, so as far as it relates to the vision, Vice Mayor.
I just wanted to say one thing, what Commissioner Gaetano was saying. I think this survey was a little difficult. I think we need to not say that the people are uneducated. I think sometimes the words are too large and they don't understand. As I was watching some people fill out their survey, they didn't understand what it was saying. So if we can make it simpler.
No, and I think brevity and conciseness and clarity is always important to everything that we do. Yeah. I agree.
Okay.
All right. Anything else on vision? All right. So, and that, I'll have you log that into. Is there anything I have to do to log in, or is it good? Can I just alt tab?
I feel like we should probably let me.
Yeah, that is probably a very good point.
We'll just start there.
Okay. So I'm going to go ahead and move on to the next, or you want me to come back? Yeah, so I'll just let you manage alt.
No, look, that's why you have good people.
Yeah.
They had an amazing team. They are really a joy. They're constantly trying to improve something. Yes.
Did you get it? Have I ever been patient? More, faster. Better. Yes. Damn, I knew there was three. I'm glad I'm better, faster. Glad I'm not being judged on that one. Okay. We got it? Logged in? Oh.
Sorry.
I'm excited. We're now on mission.
I was going to
take. It's the enthusiasm that Adam's giving me, and I'm generating it back onto the group.
I was going to take a second to just look back, go 2-3 years where the origin of that statement came from. You might remember 2-3 years ago at a commission workshop. Budget workshop of the City Commission, the Commission made it clear that one of their outstanding priorities was the landscaping of the major arterials and the streetscaping around the city, which wasn't as high on the profile then with the staff, speaking of visions, and in chasing and engaging with Public Works on raising that level up and to get it done as a top priority, that's where that first came from, the more, better, faster, on that specific kind of effort, and then it kind of translated over to other things after that. So I kick myself still. So I said thank you.
Actually, in a very concise way, it reflects what we want to see from the team. Seriously, more better.
I think so. I mean, it's if you don't like civil service and engaging in service delivery and working on seeing your community make improvements and progress and. Then you're probably not going to be happy doing this for very long. And if you do, then you should get into it and do it. And if you're going to do it, then you should be doing it at the highest level you can. That's all.
All right. Are we ready to move on to mission? All right. The excitement gets there. Same instructions. We're going to give you 5 minutes to get your thoughts together. I'm going to read a couple of examples for you. And then we're going to go back into Mentimeter and have you write out your mission statement. Some things that Amy often provides for the clarifying your mission, our purpose is to, again, action verb, who do you serve, how do you do it, and why do you do it, so it's descriptive as much as possible. Some examples of a mission statement that I thought were very interesting. Bless Toronto, to serve a great city and its people. That's its mission. You thought there was more, didn't you? There was not. Sydney, Australia, to enable a thriving and sustainable city for our current and future residents, businesses, and visitors. And then I really liked Kansas City. It was an interesting one. Oh, here we go. This is North Carolina, Wilmington. Through forward-thinking policies and responsible stewardship, we are creating a better city every day with excellent core services and quality of life for all. In Kansas City, I'll leave it with this one. To deliver quality, customer-focused municipal services with an emphasis on public safety, neighborhood livability, job creation, responsible planning for economic growth, infrastructure improvements, public health, and the environment. So that gives you some examples of what you got there. So,
can we just use
yes, that is correct. So,
is it copyrighted?
So, yeah, just Google that over, right? All right, so I'm going to set your timer at 5 minutes and give you your 5 minutes. Oh, yeah, paper first.
I thought we were supposed to write the whole thing out. I did it all. Oh, I'm ready to go.
Man, look at faster, better, more, just more. Love it.
Something that, because
We can discuss that more, but I get it. It's
hard to, it's kind of like the voting polls for the first
two. Thank you, exactly. Yeah.
Sometimes, but sometimes not.
Yeah. Yeah, and they're still off. There's a margin of error, right? Plus or minus 10%. So it could go either way.
Even at the midterms last time, it was way beyond the margin of error.
Exactly. That's a good point. We've got 10 seconds. Is anybody going to need a little more time, though? And that is the alarm. Okay, so I go to here. This is the QR code. I'm now patient and humble. So this is the QR code. Now it is in your packet as well. I get Brene Brown a lot for my staff. That's like, clear, Todd. All right, we got three in.
You signed in.
Anyone else getting texts from residents?
Yes, and tell them my mission statement.
Unbelievable.
I did. I've hit it several times. Everybody has the blue instructions and they've given the thumbs up. Mine's not changing screens.
Okay, so that may be where.
And it may be the wrong QR code. Yep.
We'll get it.
Oh, I bet you that's it, because I did the one in the packet.
Yeah, so the one will get you there as well.
Oh, my fault.
Not at all.
I think I redid the first one. That's probably exactly what I did. There we go. Thank you.
Our scope was very limited in what we were doing, but I think these are some suggestions. Oh, yes. Well, and you saw that with Kansas City, right? Because they kind of went through their whole litany, like, hey, we want to provide service that increases public health, public safety. Yeah, you can do that. Absolutely. But I mean, again, I always like something that's a little shorter. Now, maybe not Toronto, where we serve a great city. but I'm kind of impressed. If it works, it works. Yeah, because the other thing that's fun about this too now with kind of using AI tools and just general analysis is you can now also look at taking all of these words and seeing through a thesaurus, like what are all your options to either make it a little more common use. So it becomes, it's actually pretty fascinating the tools that we have available to us now, where we used to send it to, although our editor is amazing, and you just go back and forth, and now it actually is almost all automated. It makes it easy for us to turn it around. All right, 4 of 7. 5 of 7. I definitely see a common word of provide. Not the soil, the two remaining people. They're going back right now. Provide. Yeah.
You're next door today.
And we have one more. I see quality of life. I might do quality of life with flourish. That kind of okay. And then let me go down. Excuse me. Everyone can see that one. All right. So what themes are we seeing? What themes are important to you that you want to make sure that are included so you're all represented? So far we found to provide, to serve, quality. Residents are mentioned in almost every case. So either residents, everyone, people, whether that's with home. Yeah, community. I'm also seeing success in there a lot too. How do you all feel about the use of the term success?
It captures a lot, and it's the success of those residents and those families, those businesses that is the reward for a city that's conducted well is riding up to people's success, and that's in our mission statement now.
But success can be defined.
A thriving city for the success where everyone has an opportunity for success.
Yeah, like bringing in that.
No, success can be defined in different ways. I don't know that that's.
Well, and it's got to be broad enough to allow what is successful for one person and another one.
Yeah.
I tend to agree.
It's also
subjective.
I do see help. I like that word as well. I guess Yeah, that helps flourish.
And our mission is to help you blank, help you succeed, help you what? Our mission is to help you because at the end, the city is nothing without people. It's
yeah.
People-driven. It's not for
the asphalt. I agree. Amy, what did you run across when you were doing the research? What was it Etsy? Somebody actually, was it Panera, the former CEO of Panera? Give that example because I can't remember it. I thought it fits perfectly with what you guys were saying.
The former CEO of Panera had said, it isn't my job to make you successful. My job is to give you the environment to make you successful.
So you get to define it for yourself.
And he was, of course, speaking about his staff.
Yeah. We're providing, then we're creating the environment for that success. That's what I think the work will provide.
Yeah, and I think environment, let's put that on there just because it seems to encapsulate most things. So how are we feeling so far with, we've got to provide, serve, help, quality, community, success, environment, all of those elements coming in there. Do we want to have anything about service? The fact that you're providing services to do all those things. Put it in parentheses, if you will, please.
Yeah, home a few times. I think that's what is special about it is people feel like it's
home is, it is on there several times. That is a great one. It establishes what you're about immediately. Okay? How does everybody else feel about it? Did we capture it? Did you get your voice heard?
Yeah, is there anything up here that somebody else really wants in there?
The only thing I would say is I think that it's good to list that it's for businesses, for residents, and also we're a tourist town, so
for visitors. So residents, businesses, and tourists. Yeah, and ultimately that would be an interesting, we'll have to kind of figure out a play on words as to how that might percolate down to other materials so that way you can keep everyone
visitors.
And then how do you do that with your marketing, your branding? Okay. Are we good so far now with the mission? Everybody satisfied? Feel like you got the piece? All right. Excuse me. So last bit. We're almost to the end of it. Oh, no, you have to log this. Sorry. Okay, so do you want me to go? Yeah, I agree. Right. Did you want me to add it?
Yeah.
That's not my decision. I just thought it was great.
I don't love it. I think it's too broad, and we think of world class. I mean, it's so, I don't like the word class. I personally don't like it. I mean, there's a million ways to call things, but.
So you have spoken.
All right. So actually, while she's logging that in, you can actually start kind of thinking about our last item that we have today is those core values. So we're just looking for a series of words. Obviously, you'd seen with the survey. I'm going to remind you, though, of what you all came up with last time, if I can grab that, just so that way it's a little bit of a reminder. So you had before integrity, professionalism, spirit of innovation, teamwork, and pride. Now you're
good.
Yeah, so.
Say again.
Integrity, professionalism, spirit of innovation, teamwork, pride. That's what you had before.
Core values.
Yeah. All right, so some suggestions on that. Oh, laughter. Oh, do we power through, Mayor?
Yeah.
You want to take a break?
I think
because we're almost actually done with our program.
I think this team kind of probably wants to keep going. I'm open to anyone's desire. Yeah, I think we're clear-minded.
Fine.
Yeah. All right. Get some smelling salts in here. Clear the air. I like it. Clear minded.
Unless anyone wants coffee, we'll.
I right. Love that picture, though.
Yeah, go ahead and.
Yeah, let's keep going.
So same thing. We'll give you 5 minutes. So you can take your break during your 5 minutes if you have the words that you know, and then if you're done early though, let's get it going. All right. So let's move on to the next slide. There you go. That's some suggestions that we have. Action verb, definition, describe how you conduct yourself, good ideas into themes. So again, as a reminder, what you had before, integrity, professionalism, spirit of innovation, teamwork, and pride.
And this is all, just to kind of reiterate, this is how we, as in a city government, serve the community.
Yep, what your expectations are for your staff.
What values of the city government, meaning all 1,400 employees,
yep.
should they instill as they go to work every day?
You're exactly right, and that's what George and his team will look at. Those that are providing the service, are you meeting this? Are you setting the standard that our commission has set?
Okay.
Exactly. Well said.
Same thing's happening to me. Is everybody logged in?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yep, we're not to the spot yet. I'll bring up the QR code, and then you, of course, have it in your packet. You were the star pupil, weren't you? I like that you do the mic drop too, like, oh, just finished here. Aaron knows because we tell him every weekend, what did you study this weekend? Yep. We're about halfway through. We are 1 minute, 20 seconds.
Thank you.
We've got 1 minute. Okay, it looks like everyone is ready. So you guys were a minute ahead of time. Excellent. All right. And this is the QR code for your core values. And it's also in your pamphlet, so you have that available to you. I will wait to toggle. You okay? I think the vice mayor's still. Give it 1 second.
Yeah. Go higher. Go higher, so you can see the.
It keeps jumping down.
You can get it from the slide on your paper.
You're good.
We good.
You good?
Thank you. Hit the thumbs up.
Oh, there we go. Were you able to get in?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Okay, there we go. All right, 1 of 7. If somebody doesn't put more, better, faster, I'm going to be a little disappointed. I'm not going to lie.
I'm just excited for you that you.
I know, well, look, it only took 20 times, but it's not my measure of performance. So I'm like, ah. But admittedly, I was going back and saying it again and again more. I was like, get it right. Okay, Honest has popped up twice. We got 2 more. Yeah, I think, yeah. Collaborative kind of comes in there in a couple different aspects of it, but yeah, that's what I was thinking. have seven. Let me scroll down so we can see that. Okay, so motivated. All right, so what themes are you seeing? What do you want incorporated?
Trust.
Trust? What else?
Team approach, integrated.
Team approach, integrated.
Pride.
Pride.
Productivity.
Productivity. Respectful.
Innovation is always one that's thrown out, but it encompasses a lot. It's always looking for new ways to solve issues.
You do have responsive, which kind of fits several of the items that I see here, because it kind of fits with building the trust.
Responsive is great.
Yeah, I think that. All right, so we've got trust, team, pride, productivity, respectful, infrastructure, and responsiveness. Anything else?
And accountability is always a sense that is a core value. It's always there. I mean, it's a subset of the previous core value of professionalism.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're professional, you're going to hold yourself accountable to what your duties are as a...
Like resilient.
Yep, resilient. Anything else? So we got trust, team, pride, productivity, respectful, responsive, accountability, resilient infrastructure. Did that capture
infrastructure
what
is not really a value.
Yeah, it's not, but yeah, it's kind of off to the side because it does.
It's an important aspect of what we do, but when you're asking about core values of how we conduct ourselves, it's a human trait that we're talking about, not necessarily infrastructure, which is obviously important.
And that's why I think you will kind of meld that with the mission. But
yeah, it's a different aspect of all this.
Can we add continuous improvement? Is that already there?
Yeah, continuous improvement. You can add whatever like you that. Want. Like, does everybody agree with that?
Improving.
All right, so we'll scratch that and then just put MS on there. So yeah, got it. So what do we think? So we now have the elements of the vision statement given by you all, the mission statement, and the core values. Do you feel like what we have here and what we've documented on Mentimeter encapsulates what you want, what you're looking for this new upgrade?
Depends on how we put it together.
Right. Agreed. Yeah, now, and that becomes one of the real big struggles is the wordsmithing. I mean, it's a constant, like, a negotiation, a compromise, always getting there. But essentially what we're going to do, though, is we're going to take this through. We've got what you've written up. We're going to compare those words, see how many times they show up, so we at least have a measure of how often we're seeing it. And thank you for pointing out, because, yeah, if we have to separate those out, we'll do that. And essentially then we'll craft that relative to trying to mold all of these together into one, give you the statistics about how often your element, but we want to make sure that there's at least one element of everything in there. So that's going to be one of our checks that we have when we're looking at these statements and the core value is, does it reflect in everyone's? Is everyone's voice being heard? That's the important part that we're going to really make sure of. So what we'll give the city management staff is that list, that draft, and then basically how it relates to the information that you've given us. Does that satisfy what you were looking for?
So the only word that I see that's missing there that I'm sure we would all agree on is empathy. I think that's very important for our city employees, that they got to be empathetic to our residents. And I mean, honest is great, or, you know, all these things are great, but I think empathy is probably the highest or the most important. For me, I think that's the one that's missing that would be important.
Does everybody agree? Empathy?
If you're saying that the city staff should appreciate what the residents are asking for, whether it's a code issue or what have you, sure, that has to be part of it. That's part of the public service spirit that the city manager talked about.
And part of trust also, I think.
Part of trust.
Yeah, and we might mold some of these together if we need to. That can encapsulate.
Kindness.
Okay. Yeah, why don't you put dash in there?
You know, all of this is great, right? But we have so much limitation. We can come up with our strategic plan, but then when we get governing from the state that preempts us on a lot of things that we want for our communities and for our city, it almost makes it impossible for us to be able to embrace and move this forward because of the limitations that are set upon us for, you know, attacking home rule. It'll limit us on certain things that we want to do. And I think that that's a really even a bigger challenge. And how do we navigate through that? Because the state makes decisions for us that we have no say on, and it will take whatever vision or strategic mission statement that we have, and it may just throw it right out the window to some extent.
Has hurt George?
Agreed, and that's always going to be a challenge, and there'll always be limitations and things that make it tough, but all the more reason we have to stay focused on where we're going, all on the same train, and how we're going to get there. Because if you don't,
strength should be a core value.
Yeah, I mean, you've got to be persistent. You've got to be persistent. And if we stay focused on what our approach is, yeah, there's going to be problems, unexpected challenges along the way, but we'll brush those aside and keep on moving forward as long as we've got the focus and the way to get there. Yeah, so.
And I just,
please,
I'm just going to repeat the thing about engaging our residents. Because our residents vote in our state legislators and our governor, and if they understand the decisions that are being made by the legislators that are limiting what we can do at the city level, then they can help us make the change.
On a similar note, where we have teamwork, I think for me it's twofold. One is the collaboration between the city staff and the residents, so that's part of teamwork. But also, we've talked a lot over many years about having each of our departments act in a way that's more team-like. So if, for example, a police officer drives by and sees a pile of garbage, that they would contact our public works department. Mm-hmm. Similarly, if our public works department, you know, were to suspect something of a criminal nature, they would contact the police department, and on and on and on, all in that way. So I think for me, teamwork has both of those things. And somehow, I don't know if you need to elaborate on it in the core values, but I just don't want either of those ideas to get lost.
I think we can get some essence to it, though, as to what does that mean. Usually we like to at least include one sentence as to this is what that means when we're applying. So that way you know how it's implemented. Mm-hmm. I think that's very important. All right, so I'll ask again. Does this reflect what you're looking for? Again, there's obviously some wordsmithing, but I want to get that consensus that we're leaving here, because this is, you will have accomplished your mission. We'll have one small other little mission that I'd like to do since I've got you here, but are we feeling comfortable with this? Are we happy with this?
I mean, the only thing we're missing from that list and compared to what we had in our previous iteration is spirit of innovation, and that's a city that looks to use technology or used to use, you know, looks the best practices. Do we have innovation there? I don't see it.
Yeah, and yeah, why don't you put dash innovation on that? Because you're right, you're actually seeing that a lot. Even the term digital is happening a lot within city missions, core values.
Fresh ideas, that kind of. Yep.
Yeah, and we might want to include that.
Another way to say it.
I'm not seeing a lot of smiles, though. Does this hit you? I want to make sure that we're comfortable. We're good.
Future-oriented is one that we use oftentimes, but
yeah,
it kind of all goes to what we're saying here with innovation and things of that nature. Because look, one of our responsibilities is to take care of the city today and conduct through the annual budget, you know, the services that serve our residents. But a big other aspect is, you know, anticipating future needs of the city, whether that's environmental factors that come into play.
Yeah.
That could be challenges with climate change and resiliency, infrastructure needs. You know, that forward-looking aspect of things, innovations in policing, et cetera. That look forward, and I think we that's obviously one big aspect of what should lead at least the high side of city management and the elected body is anticipating the future needs of the city.
I think so, because
it's our job to do that. The average resident won't look there, but they expect us to do it.
I think that's one of the biggest responsibilities of leadership at whatever level is not only what you're doing now and for the immediate future, but the long-term future, the vision, because where you end up ultimately also means where each generation starts too, because if you start over here, you're going to be limited in how far you can get with that next generation. If you start already positioned over here, where you end up is going to be at a much higher level. You've got far more potential and opportunity then. So big
well,
time.
George, even you know, as one of the things that I reviewed before my State of the City was, I always like to take a look at the you know, population sort of trends and things. And one of the things that really stood out this time around was that our senior population in Broward County, those people that are 70 years age and older, are, is going to be doubling in the 10 to 15 yep. years in Broward County. So that tells you, okay, if we're going to have more seniors per capita in Hollywood and elsewhere in Broward County in the next 10 years, and that time will fly and get here soon, yeah. then it begs the question, are we choosing, you know, parks amenities that that cater to the seniors that that will be there in 10 years? When we build a new facility, are we choosing to invest in activities like, for example, golf and pickleball that, you know, cater to those larger, that larger proportion of 70 and older Absolutely. Residents that we're going to have? The activities that we have at the Lippman Center, the memorial does at yep. At Boulevard Heights, we should be looking to expand those. Again, anticipating where the city's going to be in 10 years, whether it's infrastructure or people, school capacity, et cetera, we have to be the ones to anticipate that looking forward. So someone in city government, of course, us elected leaders, but someone as well on the staff side should be, you know, sort of you know, collating all of that and helping us make sure that we're not, you know, not paying attention to where things are going to be in 10 years in South Florida and in Broward County.
To yep, that point, Mayor, though, to that point, we had that little glimpse of that vision, and then somehow it got, I don't want to say stage left, right? It, but we had senior living. That was one of our missions a couple years back, and we focused on it. But I think,
yeah,
to your point,
affordable housing, right?
Well, affordable housing versus senior affordable housing.
Right.
That's a big difference. So I think that we kind of had a vision of that, and then we had a little bit, so we touched it. But I think that that's really going to be so important, and that's something we really have to look into is senior housing and making sure that we encompass both the new life and the aging life. And we have to embrace that also with our healthcare system and our parks and rec, like you said, all of it. But it is going to really impact how we move forward as a city.
So
I'm glad. Thank you for bringing that up.
No, couldn't agree more. And when we talk beyond this level, when you talk about long range planning, and we don't spend enough time really looking at and updating and actively working our comprehensive plan, because you've got all those different elements in your comprehensive plan that deal with all those different aspects of life here in the community and the fabric of the community. It's all there, it has to be worked, and you've got to continue to update and move forward. We're doing that now, but it's in a kind of a catch-up mode, because yes, things went sideways for a few years, absolutely. So, but absolutely couldn't agree more.
Yep.
I mean, maybe we should focus on each district have some type of senior affordable housing in addition to workforce housing and affordable housing, whatever their term is now. But I think we really need to, you know, whether that Live Local Act bill is there, but we have to embrace a portion of it, and we should focus as a body to really address the senior living, because it is challenging for a lot of our seniors in today's world to live in the city of Hollywood, much less in South Florida.
So obviously we can talk about a lot of different subsets of population and, you know, families and how many school-aged children we have and anticipating school needs. When you take a look at those same trends, they talk about how there might be, at least not with single-family homes, but for a large part of the population, the household size is going to be 1.6 people. And so you wonder to yourself, why are they building so many one-bedroom and two-bedroom apartments? And that's like what the market is bringing. Well, it's because the household size is actually looking for those types of living arrangements, because the household sizes are actually getting smaller, separate from the side of those that are looking for single-family homes that perhaps, you know, would be still 2.56 persons per household. So a lot of these different trends impact, you know,
yep.
how we move, how we live, you know, how we serve health needs, how we choose recreational amenities. So again, it's about the people, not necessarily, you know, anything else. It's
yep.
about the people and their needs.
And that trend
and
is true a lot with the younger and middle generational age ones right now. But when you talk about the seniors and affordable housing with where the demographics are going, those multi-generational homes,
right.
that you see in so many places. That's the only way that they are able to afford housing, is that they are multi-generational homes that pass on from family to family throughout the generations. Otherwise, they can't afford to make it happen. Yeah, right. So.
But it's also the ability, not just multi-generational homes, but we talked about, or I talked about in the past, creating communal homes for seniors so that they're not living alone in a three-bedroom, two-bath house, that we have to create an environment where they can have multiple people living there, you know, yep. Kind of like the Golden Girls scenario type thing.
The era of us being extravagant with how we live is coming to a close. And when you talk about sustainability, it's all about efficiency now coming forward, because it's just not affordable anymore. And I don't mean that in dollars, but the total big picture of consumption, it's just not going right. to make it anymore.
And that's where the mixed use, you know, sort of model is coming in and kind of prevailing in because it is a more sustainable model in terms of, you know, reducing the need to jump in a car everywhere, being able to walk downstairs, attend, you know, walk to services, live together, yep. have social yep. connectivity, all of that combined. And that's what we're ushering in as a yep. county and as a city as well, and in the right places.
And the whole resiliency and sustainability, that's what it's about, is changing the way we live and how all the pieces fit together, because otherwise it's not going to fit together.
Right. Exciting times.
Yep.
Todd?
All right, one last push. Here's the area where I'd like to get a little guidance from you all. Because as a strategic plan matures, they should always include some policy statements. And in particular, there are kind of four key areas that we look at, is how often do you update it? Now, I've given some opportunities there. Either it's the number of years since last adoption, percent change of new commissioners, or a major event. I'd like to get some feedback on that, because, and we've mentioned that, when do you know it's time to do it? And I will say many will say it's one or the other, that you, and to be fair too, even if you had a percent, let's say a third of your commission changes over, you can still though verify that the plan is, and particularly your vision, mission, and core values are still there. You can reaffirm it at that point, but it's a good time to do that. So you could do, say, you know, whatever happens first between 5 years or commission change. I'd like to get some guidance on that. I'd also like to get some guidance on milestone, because as you're aware, I'll be working with your city management staff on the performance side of this, because we are going to include in a section within the strategic plan as to how is the city manager going to respond to your now, this is what we want to achieve. Okay, this is how we're going to do it. So I'd like to kind of understand, how would you define a milestone? How do you know something's done? And then avoiding distractions. It's so easy for something to come up, for a new issue, a new trend to come up. I'd like to get some guidance on that, as well as then your feelings about collecting data over the long run. And I think you kind of already affirmed that as we were talking as part of the conversation. But these are some areas I'd like to get some guidance. So if you want to do it in an orderly manner at any given time, Mayor, however you want to do this, but just a little guidance for us on the policies, because we will develop those at the same time that we're doing this. So that way you know this is how the management staff will respond, and I'll work with them then to tighten that up.
I think a lot of it is a measurement of performance and our observation as the elected body on how the city is doing as to whether or not the strategic plan needs to change. So if we're not achieving, you know, those strategic goals, or if we see a sense of a different need of the city that's not reflected, then I think that triggers the change, not necessarily any particular formula of time or elected body. I mean, there's different ways to skin the cat, but it's not just because there's you know, new elected officials here and there that, you know, the actual vision of the city changes necessarily, because the vision should reflect, you know, the actual city as a whole and not necessarily the personalities or the politics that jump on and off of a city commission. But
it's more of a measure of how you're achieving the plan, and if anything has gotten done, completed, then if there's a new event to add.
Yeah, if we feel like it's still relevant, like this update here was caused by, we felt like the vision statement from before was a little too bland and didn't personalize Hollywood enough. So when there is that sense in the future of the upcoming vision statement being, you know, not responsive to what we think ought to be the directing vision of the city, then at that point the city commission changes it. I mean, there's different ways to do it. You could just go through the exercise every few years, or the different ways you did it. There's no wrong way, but in any case, open the floor up. Commissioner Chambliss, go ahead.
I mean, I think it's definitely a hard role to establish, but I do disagree that I think a major change in a commission would require this, because I think that would give you, unless it's just people terming out, it would give you a sense that the residents aren't supportive of the policy decisions. They've elected new leaders. So, I mean, I could see something like 5 years or a greater than 50% change in the commission, or some sort of national, you know, economic change. You know, but I think it would have to have a multi-prong. If you want to come up with a formula, it would have to be multi-prong like you've suggested. But, I mean, to me, what our job is to set policy for the city. If people don't like our policies, they vote in new leaders, right? Mm-hmm. So I think it is important to tie it to that.
I just want to add, though, remember term limits as well.
Right,
so
that's what I said, except if it's term limits.
Term limits, like, you know, I've been fortunate enough to be elected into the seat.
I said that.
Right? Mm-hmm. So I think that that's really hard to base it on the board or the commission, right? Like, I'm sure you have in other cities how you follow, like if they do it every 5 years or something of that nature. But I think anybody who's coming into a seat as an elected official, our vision and our mission, it should hopefully reflect, regardless of the person who's sitting in the seat, unless you have some crazy, the idea is that it's the majority, right? So one person isn't going to change that. So what would be more, okay, so what would be more of 50% change than if we're seven
or three
or more?
I'm not saying you would have to change your statement, but the question is, when do you revisit it, you know? So in that sense, probably every 5 or 6 years, because then you
right.
will have elections.
So I don't know if we would base it on our commission body, unless, I mean, I'm sure you could always say, well, listen, you know, this is not fitting the needs of the city, and you call it back. But I think that vision statement is, because we have a pulse on the city, we know pretty much our residents' needs, or we wouldn't be sitting here in the first place. So I think that maybe, I don't know if I would base it on the commission. I think it would be like, you know, you set in time, like, what is the change? You've been doing this for so many years, so maybe you can give us some feedback so we can base it on it.
I do have a suggestion here, because one of the things that I've seen work well in the other cities is it's a reaffirmation process. So to your point, the newly elected individual could completely agree with the vision, but it gives them an opportunity to at least make a statement about it. So all you're really doing is just giving that opportunity at that time to say, do you affirm, do you feel that same way? Is there any reason to actually make that movement? Because it often is that they're in lockstep, but it at least gives them a chance to have a say related to it and say, yeah, I feel this way.
So,
Who had a hand up first, but
go ahead.
Okay.
Yeah.
I think it should be time-based, because that's objective. I mean, and reading all of this, I mean, these are generic, broad, like, feel-good words. No, I don't see somebody saying, I'm no longer into family, health, and prosperity. So I would just do it time-based, keep it objective, unless there's something excessive where 6 out of 6 commissioners get voted out while they're not termed out in a period of 2 years, maybe revisit it then. I don't know how you make that objective, but time-based. I mean, I don't see anything on there that somebody's going to run a campaign against. Yeah, home.
So I disagree. I think that it should be based on the commission at the time, whether they feel they want to revisit it. Because the issue is, you know, we have all these mandated revisiting things, right? And then when you revisit it, it gives everybody that, well, we're revisiting it, let's make sure it's changed. You know, maybe there's no changes needed, but because we're revisiting it, let's reinvent the wheel. I mean, for instance, we're revisiting, you know, in our charter, it says that we have to revisit it every 8 years. So we appoint a new body to look at the charter, and unless they figure out changes that need to be made, they're not doing their job, right? So I don't believe in mandated timeframes to revisit something.
So yours is more of like an affirmation then, because you could
listen. You get a new mayor; he might want to change the direction, and he gets consensus from the board on spending the time, energy, money on revisiting what might not be broken. You know, why fix something that's not broken, kind of thing.
So if I can respond, I agree with you. That's a better way than I just suggested, in my opinion. Yeah, and it should be on our responsibility as a body, each one of us, to review the strategic plan, and then if you need to, you go and you motion to say, hey, I think we should revisit this, and if you get a majority, then you bring it back.
I like that, too.
Yeah,
that's what
you just said.
That's the first thing that's written is new reflection.
And then it allows, because again, to the point is, if you all say, yeah, look, we affirm this is exactly what we would still want to do, it gives everybody that choice to say, I'm still in.
Yep.
So you're saying,
so process based is what
Commissioner Biederman, you're saying upon the majority vote of the commission.
Or like everything else we do, a motion and two supporters.
Yeah. Well, then it's got to get approval.
So can you put it on your annual, could we put it on our annual, like an item annually to present our mission statement? We all talk about it as a body, and then if need be, we set a workshop. If not, then we say, yep, this is exactly what, you know, we want to keep going. And that way it gives you a better time frame. It doesn't give you a time certain, but it gives you more direction.
I personally think that annually is too quick. These are broad, you know, visions and missions of the city and core values that don't really change too often. So I wouldn't want to tie it to a timeline, but I think the consensus of what we all talked
100%.
About is if the commission brings it up and there's a new reflection and someone can advocate for and achieve, you know, sort of a support for why something ought to change, and that might drive the desire to have the exercise.
If I can offer something, maybe to blend the qualitative, reflective thing along with the quantifying thing, is every year when we go through our annual budget development process, we start with a fiscal kickoff, then we have workshops in the middle, and then in the fall, several months later, we've got the budget hearings for adoption. We will always look to blend those kind of reminders and updates at the beginning, middle, and end, so you're not going to lose track of it, and at any point you feel like, wow, that's out of sync now, or we need to change that, that'll trigger your thing for the quality, and this way you don't have to worry about missing out on it. We'll kind of blend it as we go along. Yeah, all right. Yeah, all right.
And then, George, one of the things that we can do, too, or your staff would really do, is understand the trade-offs, too. So if there's an affirmation that, hey, we'd like to make that change, what are you then buying, right? Like, what do you lose in time? Because Adam and I talk a lot about you need time to actually be able to implement. So if they're able to say, hey, we're only 50% of the way there, you're getting informed then in your decision.
Not only that, if we don't get the big picture in locked in at the front end of the annual budget development process, by the time we adopt it and then it gets implemented the following year, you've missed another year's cycle, and then you're 2 years down the road. So that's why it's so important to catch it along the way there. That's like why that reference I made earlier, 2-3 years ago, when the commission said, hey, at the workshops about the landscaping, when that wasn't on our radar as that high of a priority, all of a sudden, wow, it bumped up to a high priority, and then we had to retune some of our efforts, and you can see the difference a couple years later. So,
All right, so are we comfortable now with the feedback that we've gotten on time frame update? All right, any ideas on milestone? I mean, I've got a pretty good feel for it, particularly based on kind of what you guys are accomplishing, but when we're looking at something that's data-driven, is it getting to 60%, 80%? And you're gonna have a lot of things that you're always doing, right? When you're talking about being family, community oriented, you're going to do that throughout. So it's not necessarily a milestone, but we want to make sure that we're making a plan that you can say, this is what was accomplished. I always think about your annual accomplishment report. We got this done. That becomes very important, understanding the milestones of how you were achieving the plan. Because a plan really fails when you don't see anything being done. It's just, oh, we keep planning for the future. Well, the future is also today. So what did you do today? So I did want to get some sense of how you would define those elements.
I think what George had mentioned about the annual process that kind of takes stock of accomplishments,
okay,
sort of reassesses budget priorities for the particular year coming up, is sort of always a sort of a fluid process to assess milestones, things achieved, not achieved, and what we need to focus on in a given year or in a 5-year horizon. So I feel like, personally, like the milestone measurement is kind of always happening, both within us and the city management. We have an Office of Budget and Performance that was put together, performance management. So I'd like to hear from George how we're measuring achievements and milestones.
The
said, Mary, it's an ongoing process. And then when you look in the budget document and you see all those different performance measures that we've talked about before, some in the past were kind of qualitative fluffy and didn't mean anything, so why put them in there? We've been doing our best to wean those out of there, the ones that don't mean anything, and put in real performance measures that can mean something, are quantifiable or specific, and then we hold ourselves to those, and you hold me to it when you do the annual evaluation, and you tie it all back through there. That's what, yeah, that's what you have to, yeah.
George actually kind of answered my third question then, is because that becomes a distraction. How do you identify those? And that actually seems to be part of that process. So it's almost as if all of this is part of your budgetary. And frankly, that makes sense, George, because where are you spending your money? That's your values.
And we have to, just like we talked about before, about empathizing with the public that we serve. That means we have to understand where they're coming from and not just get so focused on what we do from our end. We've got to remember what we're trying to accomplish on our service delivery. And if we're missing that and we're ending up with fluffy stuff that doesn't mean anything, then we miss the boat on it. And the bottom line isn't how many postings of such and such you did. The bottom line is how many people did you actually reach and implement something and make something happen for them, like using our dollars that need to be accelerated in getting that in the hands of the people making a difference. That's the bottom line. It's not how many times we crank the process. Yeah, so yeah, it's got to be bottom line.
So data, how about a historical data set? Do we have support on that standpoint too, of having it so you can start to actually understand the trends of these items? That's a little bit of what we were trying to accomplish last year when we were having you prioritize that, so you could see how your priorities were changing. Do things continue to bubble up? I know from my experience that just becomes really critical to be able to look at understanding what does that trend look like? Is it up? Is it down? The historical data. But I did not want to incorporate anything in there because it is a commitment. It's like doing statistically relevant surveys. It's time and money. And so I didn't want to go down that path unless you felt like it was really worth it. There's always a trade-off. There are no solutions, trade-offs.
I think through the performance management that we put in place, that's where we need to see that come from.
Yep.
The management needs to be able to assess itself and through reporting to us for us to assess the successes. I think we have the tools there. I don't think we need to create another process.
Yeah. No, and that's not where I wanted to go, but what I want to be able to do for George and the team is to just document this as part of it, so you're not going back to question it, right? You can say, George then can say, oh, this is where we do this. This is where we do it. A lot of times it's just us documenting it.
We don't need to reinvent the wheel. I think we've got the pieces in place right now. We just got to better use them and make them a little bit more clear and defined and bottom line results oriented. Yeah.
I just have a question. So in the performance measurements or quantitative analysis that we do now is based on our prior vision statement, mission, and core values, right? We tried to tie all that together, if I remember correctly. Mm-hmm. So now that this is getting redone, will there be an analysis to make sure that quantitative collection of data ties to this new and improved and revised vision statement?
Yep.
And that'll have to move to George.
Yeah, it's got to flow in both directions, absolutely.
Okay.
So we can alter what we're not only looking to do, but how we're going to measure that going forward.
Exactly.
Yeah,
so it's not just the fluff. It may be actually tweaking the data that you're collecting to make sure you're addressing these things.
Instead of looking at X, maybe, which was examined before, now we want to focus on this element or whatever, and that's got to be prospective.
Mm-hmm,
yep,
mm-hmm.
Yep.
Okay, thank you.
All right, so how are we feeling about this? I feel like I got what I needed from you all. All right, so the next steps, before we go into close, I'm gonna be working with your city management staff, bringing all this together. We're gonna be developing then a vision, mission, core values based off of the input that you've given. They'll then be sharing that with you. I would, because you do a quarterly, or no, monthly updates, agenda, right? Agenda updates?
No, every 2 weeks.
Every 2 weeks, okay. So yeah, so as we move this forward, I don't know, what do you think? 2 weeks for you and Sean to kind of get this together, at least get the strong draft before we send it to Julie? Oh, what a great team. So that will be our next step, and then essentially we will be then tying that to the performance side that we'll also be laying out within the plan. So that is our next steps. So, yeah, see? That's only one measure, though. I don't know how I did on the others, but. You still had one more.
So I just want to say I think it's really important that we're all here and we do meet on this. I know we kind of seemed like we poo-pooed the idea of how do we move forward. But it's really important to keep our pulse on how we move the city forward. And I just want to say thank you to all the department heads that actually make our city work and help us embrace this vision. So thank you to fire chief and police chief and maintenance and water. I see Vin, I see Joseph, everyone that's here. You guys and the assistant city managers really help us be able to implement this. So it's so important and we thank you for that because it takes all of us to move the city forward. And I appreciate you being here because you're important parts of the city. So thank you.
Commissioner Caleri kind of took it where the next step is, and that's what we call now, what we call the, from looking at the plan, where it all, where the rubber meets the road, you know, the strategic focus areas, and in the end, you take the vision, the mission, and the core values, and you, you know, tie that into your focus areas and how you're, you know, committed to enact this, and I'll just review it because in the end, it covers it all. Like Commissioner Caleri just said, communications and civic engagement, economic vitality, employee development and empowerment, financial management and administration, infrastructure and facilities, public safety, quality of life in strong neighborhoods, resilience and sustainability. Everything that we talked about, having a successful city in the end, requires all of this from city government, all of this to be functioning in a successful way, in a productive way, to basically take us where we want to be. And so this hasn't changed, but behind all of what we talked about today is, in the end, how the city staff implements it. So through all these different major areas, and then there's action steps under each one. And so all of that continues to be important and doesn't change.
George? Well, I was just going to say that another sports reference and analogy, that the bottom line is results. And if you look at right now with you're down to four teams and ultimately two and then ultimately one. But when you get these top few teams that are left, you see a separation between them and the wild card teams and the other teams that didn't make the playoffs. And what's the difference? The ones that have a complete organization. It's not just the players. It's the coaching staff. It's the front office. It's the player personnel. It's the the fan support. It's the whole community, the piece that all comes together. Those are the ones that end up as the very best. And you know, the only reason we should be here is to be doing the very best at the highest level we can be, and that's how you get there. You don't get it by having fragmented pieces hope to come together. You get it by tying the whole package together, and that's why this is important. So.
All right, thank you.
I mean, I guess a similar question, just based on what you just read, that was from our 2020 strategic plan. Yep. So those focus areas, when you guys go do your work, new or different focus areas, could they emerge?
There'll be clarity to them. And that's what we'll work with the city management staff. Because if we see something that's like, this isn't getting addressed, that's why we got to tie. I believe integration was a part of everybody's comment. That's why we got to make sure we're tying that together. So it's really just tying up loose ends. Yeah. Thank you all. This was really helpful. Really appreciate it. Thank you for your time.
No,
it was invaluable.
Thank you, Todd. And thank everybody for all the work. And we appreciate it because sometimes we need to be led to get to the promised land there. So thank you.
We love doing it.
Thank you all. Meeting's adjourned.